His greatest transformation was to make pictures of mere landscapes as important, as full of big ideas and feelings, as pictures of gods and heroes. He did it through his treatment of surfaces, the visual metaphors he came up with for the feeling of light. Picture by Turner of the ancient city of Carthage, supposedly founded by the legendary Queen Dido, which Turner exhibited in 1815, shows immediately where Turner always laid the emphasis, not on individual human characters, but on landscape and atmosphere.
The whole painting, its visual immediate appeal, the way it works as a painting, as opposed to the story that it stands for, the whole painting is in that yellow, and its repeat here. Above, it's a flat yellow glow. Here, it's patterned, refracted, almost geometric, this complicated illusion. Simple, complicated, a surface of water throwing off reflections. So it's a painting about reflection. And you can imagine that everything else you're seeing in it, all this busy classical imagery of marble pillars and the ancient world, is all somehow made out of that glowing light. The mood of the picture, its emotion, the story, all comes from Turner's treatment of water and light, and his concentration in this painting on that treatment, so that it's all about reflection.
Turner was an awkward cuss as a personality, a social outsider who made good but never lost his Cockney accent. But what he shared with his noble clients, who'd been brought up much more posh than him, was reverence for long-ago giants of painting. And the most popular when Turner was growing up was the 17th century French artist Claude Lorraine. In his will, Turner donated certain paintings by himself to the nation, on condition that they were hung forever near paintings by Claude. A fishing scene by Turner next to his picture of Carthage. Behind me, a painting by Claude. And here, another one by Claude, all in the same space. Turner amplified Claude's moody light effects. But instead of timeless calm and placidity, Turner brought in great turbulent feeling. In the effort to catch up, he takes over and creates his own thing. Turner becomes the great romantic artist. Turner's romantic ideal was that everything should seem to be either on the verge of dissolving or just about to be born. The whole of existence, God, humanity, the world, all arriving or departing in an awesome blaze of light.
A glow, an inner glow. It actually seems to be coming from inside this painting by Claude and then spreading and expanding outwards. So everything is arranged and planned in the painting to make that glow dramatic. And that's happening whether it's a Claude or a painting by Turner. Turner brought these pictures together in order to show that visual idea. Claude was supposed to be a classical artist who was interested in a poetic vision of the world. Turner wonders what that form of words could mean. He wants to show that it has something to do with the way light is treated, this glow emanating from the painting. It's not just that Turner wants to be associated with a great man from art history. It's a particular visual idea that unites them, that unites Turner with that great man.
Turner's imaginative flights come from near at hand inspiration. The water in Carthage is really the water of the Thames. He drew and painted imagined classical ruins on the riverbanks he knew very well. You can see one of his sketchbook pictures of the Thames becoming the ancient city of Carthage in its dawning light. Here's some other sketches of a kind of architecture inspired by classicism. This time, it's plans for a villa Turner wanted to build for himself by the river, which he did in Twickenham. He called the place Solus Lodge. And here it is. Solus is the Latin base for the word isolation. Turner got plenty of that out here. A solo existence, except for the presence of his father. Turner was a bachelor all his life, married only to his art. He had mistresses he visited occasionally that he was very quiet about, and illegitimate children by one of them, about whom very little is now known. His father did the shopping and cleaning in Solus Lodge and prepared Turner's canvases, while Turner carried on the business of being Turner. In those days, Twickenham was rural. The villa was surrounded by fields, and he could see the glinting River Thames from his top window. It was the dynamic, visual element in a leafy paradise. 10 miles away, down the winding course of the river, Turner sold and exhibited his art. And as a professor at the Royal Academy, he gave lectures on art theory. But up here, in his solitary haven, he created. He drew and sketched, and he did something else vital to his paintings. He read poetry. As an artist, it wasn't just the traditions of painting that influenced him, but also the traditions of poetry. Radical new poets emerged in Turner's time, Wordsworth and Coleridge, and then Byron and Shelley. Turner was the painter equivalent of those figures. Like them, he expressed feeling through descriptions of landscapes. But also like them, pushing forward and being advanced went naturally with a profound interest in the poetic past.
In the culture of Turner's time, because of the poetry of Alexander Pope and other now lesser known figures, the beauty of Thameside scenes like this, with its glorious light, was appreciated as a portal onto another dimension. As well as the Thames being literally a link with the past, there was also a sense of a sort of golden age of the poetic classical past, the age of gods and goddesses in nature, that somehow lingered on in the look of the Thames in the modern present. Turner more than signed up to this idea. It was really the driving motor of his Thames landscapes. Their multi-layered meanings were possible because, in his head, the Thames was already a poetic, multi-layered experience. Turner wrote poetry himself. He stuck bits of it on the backs of his canvases. He had lines of it printed in the catalogues of his exhibitions. When he wasn't painting in his purpose-built villa in Twickenham, he was writing, making up poetry in the house or out here in the garden. Today, it's not so important for us to worry whether or not Turner's poetry was any good. It tended not to have any endings. He just streamed it out in his notebooks and sketchbooks, without very much revision, as if when he was doing his visual art, he was working hard and concentrating, whereas when he was poeticizing, he was on a kind of mental holiday. The important thing is that it was a poetic vision of art that drove him. Turner's written poetry was the ordinary sort of thing that was necessary to produce the absolutely stupendous thing, his poetic painting.
Artists were conditioned to believe that poetry was superior to visual art because it could communicate more, The challenge for art was to get that multi-layered quality that poetry has. Turner does exactly this in a picture that poetically juxtaposes opposites, ordinary life and the life of the mightiest in the land.
Turner often didn't know what finished pictures his quick sketches would end up serving. Here they provide the information for a scene that has Windsor Castle, more or less in the middle, in a misty haze. The light effect he's dealing with here is atmosphere, the very particular mood that light can be the cause of as it divides up reality, creating a certain atmosphere. He's concocting all this so that the real focus is down here. Farm labourers in a moment of rest on a hard day's work. The picture is called Ploughing Up Turnips Near Slough. The year is 1809. We're at war. Our little island must sustain itself because there can be no foreign trade at the moment. The king, King George III, in his castle, is known as Farmer George. This is a rich example of where the Thames can take Turner imaginatively. It's Turner, the social commentary artist. You've got this very real scene below of the cows and turnips and the workers and their baskets, and then way above them in the misty distance, the monarch. Where is Turner mentally in all of this? And where are we? Remember, it's 200 years ago, not today. I think we're the middle class, looking down affectionately at the workers and up respectfully at the king. We're all patriots, even Turner, even though he's none of these social classes. Turner is the maverick artist, the visionary, who's using the Thames as a trigger for an idealized scene that evokes the texture of everyday life as it was lived in 1809.
Turner, the waters of the Thames also suggested another big idea of his age. How sublime, we might say today, of a sight like this, the beautiful river with its glowing light, not really thinking what the word sublime means. The sublime is a concept from the 18th century with roots in the classical past. The philosopher Sir Edmund Burke looked at the way reality is apprehended through sense perceptions. And he developed the idea that there was a dimension of the irrational and the terrifying that was something like beauty, but separate from it. He called this the sublime dimension. Burke was influenced by strange old anonymous writings from ancient Rome, which historians have agreed to attribute to a fictional author called Longinus. These said that the effect of sublime emotions and sublime language in poetry was a kind of elevated moral ecstasy. The poet Wordsworth, in Turner's own time, writing about the sublime and the beautiful, said that the poetic imagination elevates man like an unfathered vapour and makes him forever unsettled. Artists were enthralled by the notion. It meant something like nature appreciation, but also nature terror. Turner himself was formed as an artist with this concept always playing on his mind. Nature is out of scale with you. It towers above you. It meant something like God, art, the past, the ultimate, the meaning of meanings. Today it's often used to mean indifference to feeling, as in somebody is sublimely unaware of something or sublimely above something. In Turner's time, the sublime implied the greatest intensity of feeling, a state of nature, the sight of which immediately transports us to a higher level.
When I see the Thames at its most epic, I see something